Amen.
Everybody, welcome to church. It's good to see you. My name is Jeff. I'm one of the pastors here at Graceway, and we are delighted that you are with us. Hey, how about last week, Pastor Tim preached his first sermon officially on staff here at Graceway. And Ashley and the kids are here this week, so we're kind of excited about that. Continue to pray for their home to sell in Indianapolis. And I hated to miss last week. As he explained to you, Cheryl and I were in Egypt. And so last Sunday, when it was Sunday morning here, it was late Sunday night where we were. And we were in Upper Egypt at the time in generously a one-star hotel. And I was excited to see that they had internet. And I'm thinking, all right, man, we're going to tune in. We're going to watch Pastor Tim do his thing. And lo and behold, got connected. I couldn't believe it. It was like a miracle. And Tim was up here, and he was like, hey, I'm Tim, one of the pastors here at Graceway, yada, 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 going through his thing. And about 3 minutes into it, and that was all that we could see before the internet decided to take a ride down the Nile, and that was it. But We were able to see it yesterday, got back Friday night late, and great job, man. We're just so excited, and we're going to continue the same story today. By the way, speaking of that part of the world, as you know, a few weeks ago, we were praying for a couple of our partners in Turkey to be able to get out. They had been detained at the airport on their first attempt, and we were fearful that maybe something worse was going to happen, but as you know, they've been here for several weeks, and this morning, we're delighted to have one of our key world partners with us, Jacob. And that's all I'm going to say for reasons of security, but Jacob is with us today, and he and his family have also decided that God would have them step aside from what they've been doing in Turkey and go to a neighboring country, and we'll have more to say about that later, but I would ask that you pray for him and his family and all of that. Just wonderful to see what God does when his people are faithful. So on the 22nd of February, Wednesday night, Cheryl and I were getting ready to go to Egypt when the shooting happened at Austin's Bar and Grill in Olathe. Y'all remember that. It was all over the news. And you know the details, and I'm not going to go into a lot of trouble to reconstruct the story, but basically there were two Indian engineers who frequented that particular establishment a couple of times a week as friends. They worked down the street at Garmin, and some deranged individual came in and began tossing around racial insults. They were from India. He thought they were from the Middle East. Wasn't the sharpest guy evidently in the world. And when he started doing this, a young man who was also an engineer but did not know them actually stood up for them and was defending them. You know the story, and they ushered the bad guy out. He came back in later with a gun and shot all three of them, the two engineers and the Good Samaritan bystander. Unfortunately, one of the Indian engineers passed away. The other two were critically wounded, and yet they survived, and we're very grateful for that. But I can remember seeing him interviewed like a day or two later from his hospital bed, and he said, you know, I'm not a hero. I just did what I think every person should do, something to that effect. Well, my question for us this morning is this: would I? Would you? And honestly, none of us can definitively answer that question until the situation arises. What does it take to be someone of courage? What does it take to be a community of courage? And that's what I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about courage as we look at the aftermath and the burial of Jesus Christ. The aftermath of the crucifixion, the burial of Jesus Christ. What does that mean to us? Because I do believe that there are certain steps that we can take to be prepared for those totally unexpected moments in life that in large part become life-defining moments, and we don't really know how we are going to act until the situation arises. How can we be prepared for the unexpected? So I want to talk about courage, and we're going to be using the story of Jesus' burial to do that, because can I just tell you this right off the bat? There is no greater act of courage in all of history than what Jesus Christ did for us when he bravely faced the mob, when he was crucified, when he hung naked on the cross and died in order to pay the price for your sin and mine and to cover our sin and our shame. And what we're going to see today is the burial of Jesus Christ. Last week, we gave Tim a passage that was about three times too long for his first sermon here at Graceway, and said, okay, Tim, you're going to talk about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. By the way, welcome to Graceway. Kind of make it light, you know, kind of tell your life history at the same time. Basically, walk on water, Tim, and everybody will applaud you. You did a great job. And so, but that just happened to be where we were in the process of going through the book of Luke. And so now we're looking at the burial of Jesus Christ. And you might be saying, so what does that story have to do with courage for us? Well, not only do we see the courage of Jesus Christ, who died, was buried, and rose again for us, but there are two focal points in this story that I want us to look at from the standpoint of community. And that's what we've been talking about, redeeming community. What does that mean? That Jesus has redeemed us, that we might be a redeeming community. And what I want us to see this morning is that Joseph of Arimathea was indeed a man of courage, remarkable courage. Why? How did he get that way? And secondly, we want to see a group of Galilean women who likewise demonstrated phenomenal courage, risking everything to do so. Where did that courage come from, and how do we, as followers of Jesus Christ, get that type of courage? And before we even get into our text, let me just pause for a second. Let's talk about courage itself. Let's try to define what courage means for just a little bit. Courage begins, I believe, with a God of the Bible. He is the source of true, genuine courage. I'm not talking about ratcheted up macho type courage. I'm talking about genuine courage that resides in us and springs to the forefront at those most unexpected moments. How does that happen, and what does this mean? Our English word encourage, have you ever thought about the fact that courage is related to discourage and encourage? You know, I think about all these weird things, but seriously, discourage and encourage are intimately connected to courage. And so maybe you came in this morning discouraged. Maybe you've lost a loved one. Maybe you've lost a job. Maybe you lost a vision. Maybe you're facing a challenge that you've never contemplated before, and you're like, wow, I'm just a little fearful. I'm a little afraid. What do I do? How do I handle this? I'm discouraged. I'm lacking in courage. Have you ever thought of it that way? Being discouraged is an emotional state, but it's also a very tangible lack of courage. So encourage, that's what I want to do today. I want to encourage you so that even if you came in discouraged, you can leave encouraged in just a few moments. In fact, that word encourage in English comes from the Anglo-French, and it means literally in courage, even though we spell it with an E. In other words, courage is something that comes into us from the outside. It's not that some people are born cowards and some people are born brave, but rather something or someone puts courage in us. That's what the word encourage means, to put courage into. Now, biblically, I believe that courage is put into us by the God of encouragement. So let me share a couple of biblical references with you. And I want to start in Romans chapter 15, verses 4 to 6, because courage ultimately comes from God himself. And Paul makes this very clear here in verse 4, for whatever was written in former days, now he's got in his mind what we call the Old Testament, was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement, through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is the God of encouragement, the God who wants to put courage in us. And one of the ways that he does that is through the Scriptures that encourage us. The Scriptures put courage in us. But God also has other means to put courage in us. And one of the ways that he does that is through others. Listen to what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 8. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. part of our responsibility as members of the community of Jesus Christ is to put courage into the other people around us. Encourage each other. He goes on to say in chapter 5 and verse 11, therefore encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. Now, I don't want you to cop out this morning by saying, well, I'm just not a very courageous person. I'm just kind of a wimp. Well, let me put some courage into you. You don't have to be like that. There is hope. And there is courage available, even in the most dire and difficult situations. So what I want to do this morning, I want to encourage you. In fact, we have a role model of that in the New Testament. His name is Barnabas. That's what his name means, encourager. And you look at his personality in the book of Acts. He was constantly encouraging people, coming up alongside of someone, putting courage into them. That's what you and I need to be doing with each other. Now, let's go to Luke chapter 23. We're going to look at the last verses here, verse 50 to 56, because this is a story of courage in the midst of incredible sorrow. We'll begin reading in verse 50. Jesus is dead. Pastor Tim took us to this point last week. Now, there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council. We sometimes call that council the Sanhedrin. Does that make sense? You might have heard that word as much as you have the word council if you read through the Bible. It was the highest ruling body of the Jewish people at the time. And it says he was a good and righteous man. Now, interestingly enough, that same Greek word for righteous was used just right before this by the Roman centurion who witnessed the death of Jesus on the cross. And you remember what he said? Truly, this was a righteous man. Now, Dr. Luke is writing this, okay? He's just used that word that the centurion used to describe Jesus, and he uses the same word to speak of Joseph, a member of the ruling Jewish council. We often consider all of them to be just hopelessly fanatical, religious zealots that have lost contact with reality and God, but not all of them. He was a good and righteous man. Verse 51, who had not consented to their decision and action, and he was looking for the kingdom of God. You know, as we've gone through the book of Luke, all the way along, this has been one of the major themes. People who are looking for the kingdom of God. They're not looking for what they can get. They're not looking for their religion, their tradition. They're not looking to defend the way things that have been. They're looking for the kingdom of God. And we've seen that from the very first chapters of Luke to this point. And the question is, are you and I aligned with what we want and desire, or are we aligned with the purpose of God? Are we looking for the kingdom of God? And then it says in verse 52, this man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Now that's powerfully significant. Let me explain to you why. In Jewish culture in the first century, having a proper burial was everything. And not to have a proper burial, and this is going to sound really weird to you if you've grown up here in the United States, not to have a proper burial as a Jew in the first century was a fate worse than death. And you say, what do you mean? I mean, you're either dead or you're not, and if he's dead, what does it matter whether he has a proper burial or not? Because the society, the community in which Jesus was walking was not an individualistic community like ours, but a very communal society. And so someone that did not have a proper burial not only brought shame upon themselves, they brought shame upon their entire family, listen to me, for generations to come. Can you begin to understand the issue here? For generations to come, if you were of that lineage, you would be known, oh yeah, your great-great-grandfather was the one that was crucified and not buried properly. And you would have to deal with that from whenever you learn to communicate with other people. It would be part of your life. It would be an issue of shame for you. And so Joseph wants to avoid that. He asked for the body of Jesus in verse 53. Then he took it down and wrapped it in a linen shroud and laid him in a tomb cut in stone where no one had ever yet been laid. In other words, this is a cave-like tomb that typically would be used only by the rich and powerful, which Joseph was. He was rich, he was powerful, but he was not one of them. And so this was the cemetery plot, as we would say today, that evidently he had bought for his family, the family mausoleum, if you want to look at it that way. And nobody had ever used it yet. And Joseph said, I've got to put Jesus in there to give him a proper burial. I've got the plot. I might as well use it. I will do that. And then in verse 54, it says, it was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment. Now, this is an inclusio. You've heard me use that word before. When the word Sabbath is used in verse 54, and then it's used again in verse 56. And what that does, it frames this passage to say, look what's happening in regard to the Sabbath. Jesus has just been crucified as a criminal, a lawbreaker, somebody that was out to destroy the religion of the Jews, and yet here are his followers very carefully following the law, very carefully conforming to society in order to give their Lord a proper burial. This was not like the mob mentality had it. So that's what happened. That's the primary meaning of this passage. But now the question before us that we've been asking as we've gone through this portion of the Gospel of Luke, what can we learn about community, our need for community, and how it functions, and why it's such an important part of our life, why you need community and I need community, no matter what you call it, no matter how it's structured, we need community. What is about this? Jesus was redeeming community and forming a new community that would be a redeeming community. As Pastor Tim said last week, being part of a redeeming community starts with us remembering that we are a redeemed community. We have a purpose. We have a mission in life. So Joseph finds courage from his faith in God to stand against community gone wild, a community that had the scriptures, that professed strongly to believe the scriptures, every word of the scriptures, but yet they missed the message, blinded by their many religious traditions, blinded by their quest for religious power and influence. This community that God so badly wanted to redeem, so that it could be a redeeming community, totally missed the message and missed their Messiah. They refused to submit to the Redeemer. That's why it's so important to see that the ladies are keeping the law. They're not rebellious. They're not terrorists. These Galilean women find strength in their faith, but also in the community that they had together. Now remember, they're Galileans. They don't live in Jerusalem. And remember that Galilean Jews were looked down upon by the Jews in Jerusalem and Judea. They didn't consider them to be real Jews. So they didn't go home the night of the crucifixion. They had no home to go to. They were from Galilee. They're staying with friends. They're doing whatever they can. And so it was a terribly confusing time. And so for them to follow Joseph to the tomb and carefully note where Jesus was laid so that they could come back later and anoint his body with spices for a proper burial, y'all, that was incredibly courageous. They found courage, and I believe that one of the things that encouraged them is that there were several of them. We're not told exactly how many, but there were numbers. When you're in a rough situation, isn't it better to have people with you? You know, I've taken people to Europe every year for a long, long time, and one of the things that I always like is when we're there, and even though we've done training and I've told them how to order and how to do the meal thing in Europe, that first time when I say to them, okay, guys, that's kind of the end of our organized activities for the day, so go out and find a place to eat, and we'll see you in the morning. And people who have not traveled a lot, sometimes people who have not been to Europe before, or maybe to any other country, they just kind of stand there going, they're like, dude, we're in Paris. They speak French here, and I don't. Yeah, but go find you something to eat. That'll be okay. Those are the moments when you want community. Even though you may have to have community with somebody that you don't particularly like, you know, even though the clown jester that is on the trip or whatever, you know, you want somebody with you so you can go sit down in a restaurant and order off a menu where you don't understand a single word and the waiter doesn't speak your language. It's a lot easier to do that when you're with other people, isn't it? You ever been in a situation like that? I'm laughing at a couple of people with me last year. Now, please understand that you don't have to be suave and experienced to make mistakes. I do all the time. Just a couple of years ago, here's Jeff, been all over the world, okay? So I'm by myself one night in Paris, and the group has gone out. I got left by myself. I thought, hey, no problem. I will go find me a nice place to have me some dinner. I found this beautiful little Parisian cafe, went in and sat down. I thought, hey, a pizza sounds great. Now, let me give you some background information. I detest, despise, and hate anchovies. Okay, I just want you to know that. If you like them, I love you. Just don't get them to where I can smell them or be near me. And when you talk about putting anchovies and pizza together in the same breath, I want to vomit right here in front of you this morning. And so I sit down in this little cafe, and so the waiter comes up, and in my very best French, I'm ordering a pizza. Now, let me explain something else. My very best French, if you had a year of French in high school and flunked, your French is better than my best French. Okay? Are we understanding each other? And so he comes up and I order this pizza that I think is going to be something, and when it finally arrives, it is totally and completely covered, saturated with nothing but anchovies. And I am freaking out. And I was asking God for a community that had somebody in it that loved anchovies so that I could order something else. And at that time, you know, you can't even explain to them what the problem is or whatnot. You just kind of suck it up and you eat a few anchovies to have something in your stomach before you go to bed. And then, you know, thank you, but that's enough. So those times when, man, it's so comfortable with somebody else. Now, my situation is pretty lighthearted, but can you imagine these women who have followed Jesus now all the way from Galilee, and Jesus is dead, and they're terrified to think that he would not have a proper burial. And together, they find the courage to say, we're going to follow, we're going to see where they lay him, and we're coming back after the Sabbath, and we're going to properly anoint his body so that we spare our Savior from that shame of not having a proper burial. We all need community, right? We've been talking about that the last several weeks. But community can be good or it can be bad. Community can drive you away from God, or community can drive you to God. And so it's not just community in itself, but it is a redeeming community that we've been talking about that we need. A community that has a missional purpose. So let's draw a few lessons from Joseph and the Galilean women. First of all, follow your conscience, not the crowd. And that's what Joseph did. We lump the Sanhedrin all together, and stereotypes are horrible. But we're all guilty of them, right? Every Muslim wants to slit my throat. No, that's not true. You know, everybody that watches Fox News is a conservative idiot. Everybody who doesn't watch Fox News is a wild-eyed liberal. No. We have all of these stereotypes that we function with. And so we often think of the Sanhedrin, lump everybody together. Oh, these are the guys that hated Jesus and delivered him up to be crucified. Well, yeah, as a group they did, but it doesn't mean that there were not members on the Sanhedrin like Joseph who were good and righteous and did not consent to that. So be careful with that. Crowds can become more powerful than an opiate quickly. It was just a week earlier when Jesus was riding a donkey through Jerusalem and the crowds were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna! Worshiping the one who came in the name of the Lord. And now, just hours before, they're saying, crucify him, crucify him. That's sometimes what we call a lynch mob mentality. Aren't you glad we don't have lynch mobs in America much anymore? Oh, but we do. We just call them by a different name. Today we call it Facebook. And it happens every day before our eyes. We see the mob pile on people who, for whatever reason, are the objects to be crucified that day. And so people just pile on and pile on and pile on. So what do? Do you just jump in and pile on? Or do you, like Joseph, step back and say, wait a minute, what's going on here? What does Scripture say? I have to inform my conscience with Scripture. I have to know what is going on here in order to make the wise and the correct decision. That's how your conscience is informed. And the second lesson that I think we need to learn is to never be distracted from the mission. And that was another characteristic of Joseph. He was one who was, listen to this, looking for the kingdom of God. He was not looking for what he could get for him and his family. He wasn't looking for convenience. He wasn't looking for a place to worship that had only the style of music that he liked, or this or that, or just people like him. No, he was looking for the kingdom of God. He never lost sight of the mission. It's easy to do. We had a town hall meeting with Pastor Tim a couple of weeks ago with leaders, and we've got another one coming up tonight and Wednesday, and he'll be telling you about that in a few minutes. But in response to a question, I've even forgotten what the question was, but I loved his answer, and his answer basically was, look, hey, let's not get sidetracked by all the many things that we can argue about. Let's focus on the mission and what God has put us here on this planet to do. Let's focus on that. And that's the type of guy that Joseph of Arimathea was, and that's why he was able to find some courage. And then, as the women did, we find that courage also in community. And I believe that these women from Galilee, these marginalized women, first of all, women didn't have a lot of influence in the first century. We've talked about that many times. But to be Jewish women from Galilee, it's about as low as you could get. And so here they risk everything to go to the tomb, committed after the Sabbath is over, to anoint the body of Jesus with spices for a proper burial. Wow. Finding that courage. But there's a lesson here that I think is even much more profound and important. Those lessons are pretty easy, right? Follow your conscience, not the crowd. I mean, your mom told you that before you read the Bible, right? Son, if everybody else jumps off the cliff, why are you going to jump off the cliff? Everybody else jumps into the fire, why would you jump into the fire? You ever heard that speech? Or if you're a parent, you've probably given that speech hundreds of times. Yeah, that's pretty obvious, and to be able to keep your mind and heart focused on the mission of God, that's pretty basic. Finding strength in community, we've been talking about that now for several weeks, and that's why you need community, I need community, whatever you call it, whatever shape it takes, whatever structure it has, we need community, we need each other. The Bible is filled with one another's. Encourage one another, put courage into each other. But here's another lesson. As we get courage, we need to have the courage to bury what needs to be buried. We need to have the courage to bury what needs to be buried, and I think that this is one of the main points of this story. Joseph and the women found the courage to bury Jesus properly. And it came from everything we've talked about, from following their conscience, not the crowd. It came from the scriptures, keeping their minds and hearts focused on the mission. It came from the strength of community. And obviously, there was a sense of respect and honor that was built into their cultural worldview. But they must give Jesus a proper burial. But there's more at stake here. You see, without a burial, there's no resurrection. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is all about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And normally when we talk about the gospel, we talk about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We kind of pass over the fact that, no, he was dead and buried. And when he appeared again, risen, he was not a cadaver that came to life after a few minutes on the operating table. He was not just a disembodied ethereal spirit that appeared to his disciples. No, this was the same Jesus that had been crucified and put in the tomb for 3 days. He was buried. Without true burial, there is no miraculous resurrection. And here's just a real practical aspect of that. Stay with me. Things not buried soon stink. Remember the story in John chapter 11 about the death of Lazarus, Jesus' friend? Jesus and his disciples went there, and he said to Lazarus' sister, roll the stone back from the grave. And his sister said, Lord, he's been dead for 4 days. He'll stink. And Jesus said, listen to me. Roll the stone back. He was getting ready to raise him again from the dead. But this is just a fact of life. Things not buried soon stink. Go through the list of relationships and circumstances in your life, and I would imagine you've probably got a few things that would be better off buried instead of you dragging them around. I had a very close friend many years ago, best friend in the world that I had at the time, and went through a series of circumstances. It's been way over 30 years ago, and our relationship ended. I lost contact with him totally. And this is my best friend. And a couple of 3 years ago, I get an email, and he says, hey, I found you on the internet. I've been reading your blog. I like what I see. I hate it that we're not friends anymore. I feel like I've lost a part of my life. Would you please forgive me? And I wrote him back immediately, says, hey, please forgive me. But you see, after I'd done everything that I knew how to do, only thing I knew how to do then was to bury it. You know what God did? He resurrected it. And I love that, because only God could do that. It wasn't me forcing it. It wasn't me making it happen. God just resurrected it. But there's no resurrection without burial. One blessing of getting older is to have a vast collection of life experiences from which to draw wisdom. One of the curses of getting older is the temptation to hold on to things and drag them around with us till we go to the tomb ourselves. And so here we are, dragging stuff around with us. Hurts or pains or broken relationships or the way that we used to do this or that. I love what Pastor Tim said a couple of weeks ago. Hey, when we go through a transition like this, there's two different extremes. People who want to hold on to the past and people who want to totally forget the past. And the truth is right in the middle. We need both. And this is what I'm talking about here. There is a truth here that we need to understand. And this happens to anybody. It happens to young people. But I'm going to talk for people who are older like me. Right at the time in life when we have the wisdom and the experience to offer to a younger generation to keep them from making some of the mistakes that we have made, sometimes they don't want to get close to us because we're dragging around some stinking, rotten carcasses that stink. And nobody wants to get close. Bury them. Bury them. Find out what needs to be buried and bury it. Don't live in the past. Change. I was talking to a guy this morning, a good bit older than me. That was his message to me. He said, man, he told me about all the stuff that he's been doing in just the last 20 years of his life, learning four different languages and learning to study the Bible and teaching the Bible and going out. And here's a guy a lot older than me. And I'm like, man, that's my hero. I want to be like that one day when I grow up. Young people, don't start. Don't start dragging around stuff. Bury it. Put it behind you. And if God wants to resurrect it, then God will resurrect it in His time and His way. Is the community around you reinforcing God's mission? Or drawing you from God's mission? That's the question we have to ask ourselves. Community is not good just for the sake of community. I want community. I want community too, and we need community. But make sure it's a missional community and not just a me community. There's a huge difference there. Are you joining in the crowd wanting to crucify the latest victim every day? And it doesn't just happen on social media. It can happen at work. It can happen at school. Maybe there's somebody at work or school that is that awkward person for whatever reason. Maybe they're an immigrant. Maybe they don't speak English well. Maybe they're just socially awkward or whatnot. Nobody wants to eat lunch with them. In fact, sometimes people want to make fun of them and want to attack them. You may never be in a situation in a bar when you get shot trying to defend a couple of people, but every single one of us has been in situations like that where people are getting verbally crucified around us. Would you have the courage to stand up to a situation like that this week, like maybe today or tomorrow, and to say, I'm not going to let it go any further. I'm going to stand up. I'm not going to jump in and pile on. I'm going to have the courage to stand up and say, hey, wait just a second, time out. Let's talk about what's right. Let's talk about what's true. Instead of allowing people to be verbally crucified by immature people caught up in a mob mentality, stand for God's mission. Let's grow in our understanding of God's truth and put courage into each other. And that's what's going on here. A man and a group of women from a God of encouragement and from the scriptures of encouragement and from the community that they have are having courage put in them to do something that very few people honestly would do. Where are the 12? 11 now. Where are they? How come none of them have come forward to give Jesus a proper burial? And from the people that you would least expect, a member of the Sanhedrin and some Jewish women from Galilee step up to the plate and say, we're going to do what's right. And Graceway, that's the type of church we want to be, where we do what's right for the sake of being right, because it's the truth that we have in the Scriptures, and the God of encouragement puts courage in us to do what is right. And even when it seems like there's not enough, then we encourage each other. We take the Scriptures, we encourage each other, we build each other up in order to do what is right. I'm so excited about what God is doing, so excited about the future. But it's going to require courage from all of us. And not to be the first church of Me Too, but to be the first church of doing what is right because it's right. And I believe that that's exactly what God wants to do right here. Let's pray. God, would You encourage us this moment? Lord, I am absolutely certain that people have come in this morning in different stages of discouragement. And God, I pray that Your word this morning and the example of Joseph and the women would put courage in them to stand up to whatever situation, to stand up to whatever challenge, to refuse to pile on to the people around them. Lord, I pray that every one of us this next week would be used by You to put courage in someone else. God, would You challenge each of us to pray that daily this week? God, show me today who needs some courage that I might encourage them. Lord, we love You. We're so excited about You. May You be honored and glorified in all things. Amen.
All right. Did you enjoy that today? That was a good word. Thank you so much, Pastor Jeff. And maybe just jot some stuff down. You know, maybe you're in here today and God's saying to you, there's an area that I need you to stand up courageously. Or maybe God's saying, there's someone that I need you to put courage into. Or maybe God's saying, man, it's time to bury that thing so I can resurrect it. I think I might have all three, I'll be honest with you. But thank you for that word. That was so good. Listen, if you're a guest with us, thank you for being here. I know you could have been anywhere else on the slick roads of Kansas City. Someone texted me yesterday and said, did you make it here through the blizzard? And I said, oh, I didn't notice that y'all had a blizzard. But we're glad that you're here today. I would love to meet, I know Pastor Jeff would love to meet you. So if you go out these doors and head left, you'll see Guest Central. Love to shake your hand. We have a gift for you. If I haven't had the chance to meet you, would you just stop by real quick, introduce yourself? I would love to give you a hug and try my best to remember your name. But thank you so much for being here. A little bit of housekeeping for us. We got some guests who are going to be coming to Graceway over the next few months through our sports leagues. And so we are looking for some help to help clean up our house. We got some ball fields that need a little raking, need a little dirt or lining or something. I don't know. But we're going to feed you lunch, feed you breakfast. And I would encourage you, if you are a parent, this is a spot for you to grab your kids, say, we'll get donuts on the way, and we're going to go and we're going to serve. Because this is a huge, huge outreach for Graceway to our community. And so if you would just jot down the date that's behind me, we'll feed you, just need you to show up. That'll be a great time. We'll have a good time and we'll get the house in order before our guests show up. Number two, tonight, 6 o'clock in this room, yes, in this room, okay, they're shaking their head, yes, is the firing squad, town hall meeting with the Duns. And so I am one of the Duns, and so I will be here tonight and just doing some Q&A. Love to meet you. My wife will be here. My kids will be here, probably running around acting crazy. But if you'll show up, love to just have a conversation with you and answer any questions that you might have. Okay? Are you all good? Are you glad you came to church today? I'm glad you came to church today. Why don't you stand with me? We are going to go into our time of offering. Let me tell you a real quick story on this. The church that my wife and I are coming from, whenever we would do the offering, everyone would clap and cheer because we had the chance to be generous because we serve a God who's been generous to us. And so we're going to head into that time. Let me pray for the offering and then we will sing, God, I love You today. I love You because You love me first. I thank You that You're a generous God who gives exceeding abundantly more than I could ask or think. All the things that You have seen fit to give to me, God, I'm just in absolute awe of it today. And so, God, grow us into a generous church. Grow us into a church that serves and gives and loves deeply and be glorified through it. We love You, and we pray these things in Jesus' name.